Good evening. Welcome to the eighth session of American Pro Se Hour. I'm your host, Carl Frederick. My regular guest here, Fred Scapato, was ill, so he's not with us. But our guest made it, and that's what's important, and he's Mr. William Brigiani. He is an attorney in East Brunswick. He also teaches municipal court law at Ickle seminars and to judges and lawyers. And he's a past president of the Middlesex County Bar Association. Let's cover some business and some various details before we welcome Mr. Brigiani. First of all, has the disclaimer that you saw on the screen indicated for those that couldn't read the small print. We do not give legal advice. We give you information, and from the few facts that we get here, quick on the air, it's not possible to give anybody legal advice. So what we must do is we must give them information which can be refined later by a professional into advice. And that's why it's important to always check anything with a lawyer. What we can do is help you know how to deal with a lawyer, who to deal with at times, and how to not waste money and to be prepared. We also have a drawing, and the drawing is done basically on Thursday after we figured out who we have full names for. And I always have a pretty girl pick the labels, and the two that win get the book sent to them. And everybody gets on for the free year subscription to Proceeding Pro Se. American Pro Se, as you know, is a not-for-profit. All of us are unpaid, and the guests that show up here are attorneys who donate their time to help inform the public. And you are the star of the show, so feel free to call in at any time and ask a question on any subject, and we will try to help you. However, tonight's guest is going to present on municipal court, which most of you will get into at least once in your life. And so that's the area that most of you may want to take advantage of tonight. But any question goes. You are the star of the show. If you don't call, there are no stars. We're just here to help you. We're the supporting cast. And with that, welcome, Bill.
Thank you.
And tell us a little bit about municipal court and how somebody should proceed.
Well, if you find that you're in municipal court by virtue of a criminal complaint or a motor vehicle ticket, you really ought to read the ticket and read the criminal complaint. The ticket says to you that if you plan to plead not guilty, you ought to call the court 3 days before the hearing. If you do not, you will go to the court, and by virtue of the shift assignments, the police officer is not going to be there. It's going to cost you another trip to court. You ought to look up the statute for which you're charged. It may be you have a defense for it, but all you know is maybe you went through a red light or you had a speeding case, and there are various defenses available to you. You have to be educated. You can do it on your own if you want to. Of course, the more serious things like drunk driving, revokeless, etc., and the disorderly persons offenses, assault, cases of that type, you really ought to consult an attorney and decide how you're going to proceed.
Okay, but now they've got to go to court, and let's assume that at least at the moment they can't initially afford an attorney, or they haven't found one. Explain, you know, what do I do? I've got this ticket. I can't afford any more points. If I get any more points, I'm going to lose my license. My insurance is going to go up. When I go there, are they going to try the case, or do I go first and plead? Or walk us through exactly what they do and what they need to do, and especially if they don't have money for a lawyer and it's a traffic ticket.
All right. Traffic ticket. First thing you do is call the court, and then you confirm it by writing, indicating you're pleading not guilty. You next write a letter to the court and to the prosecutor requesting discovery. Discovery are the police officer's notes, the police reports that the officer is going to rely on when he and the prosecutor face you in court. You're entitled to these as a small charge. The municipalities charge you for the discovery. Make sure that you tell the prosecutor by letter and the court who your witnesses are going to be. as part of the reverse of the discovery process, as you're entitled to know who the witnesses are against you, so the prosecution has to know who the witnesses are against them. When you finally get the court date, dress appropriately, jacket and tie, a business suit, whatever, and have your witnesses there. A witness at home does you no good. A writing you wish to rely on at home does you no good. Your evidence and your witnesses must be before the court.
Now, Bill, you say writing, but if I take a letter in that my friend Joe wrote, and he said, I was watching and the light was defective, can I use that letter, or do I need him to establish that that was his letter? I mean, explain to me how I lay the groundwork if I've now got to present my own case. Explain the elements of what constitutes evidence as opposed to what people think evidence counts, and how they can get it into the system so that the judge isn't not allowing it. Because a lot of people say, well, I went to court, I showed this, I don't understand how the judge found me guilty. And the reason, of course, is because you didn't present it so that it qualified as evidence, so the judge couldn't consider it. So explain to them how they get what, you know, they think is evidence to be made into evidence so that it can, in fact, be considered by the judge. I think it's real important.
When I refer to a writing, it could be typewritten, handwritten. A defense for, let us say, driving on the revoke list is a letter from Trenton, a writing, indicating that your license was restored to you the day before you received the ticket. That would be a good defense, and that letter would be admissible. If there is a witness who is unable to come to court and they write you a statement saying, I saw the whole accident and you did not go through the red light, the light was green for you and red for the other driver, that letter is hearsay. It's the statement of someone not in court and is not admissible since it cannot be cross-examined. Other writings or typewritten elements of evidence which are admissible would be your insurance card to show you are insured, a firearms identification card to show that you have the right to possess a firearm, and any other government-authorized or government-issued ID card, letter, etc.
Yes. Okay, so now your person's in there, and they can't use it hearsay, so they've got to bring the witness. If they can't bring the witness, they can ask for an adjournment.
Correct.
Okay. But now, let's say they have a reluctant witness.
Then you would subpoena that witness. You want to subpoena all your witnesses, because should that person not show up in court, the judge is going to say, did you subpoena the witness? And if your reply is, well, he's a friend of mine, I thought he would show up for me, that will not give you the necessary protection.
Okay. And we have a call from a Gary. Hi, Gary.
Hi, how are you?
What can we try and do for you?
Well, I have a question. My brother was involved in an incident yesterday in a township near here. He was leaving his place of business, and he was driving home. A car had stopped short in front of him. He hit his brakes, almost hit the vehicle, exchanged a few choice words with the driver. The driver then had gotten out of his car, ran towards my brother's vehicle, pulled him from the vehicle, assaulted him, and then, I forgot one thing, then pulled his badge and showed that he was the chief of police of the township and that he shouldn't have been riding so close to him, and he'll pull his driving privileges and he'll do this and do that. He hit him in the head with his fist and kicked legs apart and attempted to frisk him. And my brother called a couple of attorneys today, and everyone says, don't pursue it, leave it alone, you'll get reparation, you know, you'll get